pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And yes, don't let us forget Calvary and your son, Jesus, and what he did for us. And we're here today, Lord, we sing worship to you and praise to you. We just lift up the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for your grace and your mercy. We just ask that the Spirit be with us today and soften hearts that we can hear what we need to hear. And just bring the word to the pastor that he may give us the message that we need to hear as well, Father. We just praise you and thank you. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
The song was now number
330 and 12.
shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they too shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife, even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. May the Lord bless you in his word. You may be seated.
Wow, you are turning to number 400. Doesn't appear any place. Because, how many folks would we have the offer to offering? We have special music. Do you like that?
Matt. Yes.
Thank you. It's your opportunity to provide that now, because we're going to have a time of maybe a choir practice or so for people who want to come out and sing for a special for that time period when we have offering. We're going to have this starting on the 19th of this month, so we're giving you some time to prepare. It'll start around 5 o'clock. We're going to choose a song that's familiar. If you know parts, we're going to do parts. If you don't know parts, but you just want to come out and sing, we're going to do that. So we're going to have a choir, if you will, for special music's coming up, and it begins on the 19th. And the other one, I don't know for sure because I haven't looked at the calendar, but I hear by high authority that you asked me, why would I know? You're not sure. Don't ask me, I lost my memory last weekend. I'm not sure. A time change is coming. When is that, folks?
Next week.
Next weekend. So you are sure. And I'm, well, like I said, you put two minds together, we might one. Okay, so don't forget the time change next week. It's number 400, and what? What did you say? Way too much stress here. I'm about ready to lose one. Just for standing, we're doing 400.
Oh,
4-0, we can sing the first verse.
4-0.
In the area of prayer, I want to remind you to pray for a few people specifically. Pray for Ann. Ann has a port put in for chemotherapy tomorrow, right, Ann? So she has cancer and she's going to have surgery. She has to have chemotherapy. So really pray for Ann. And then back there in the back, Keith, raise your hand up. Praise the Lord. I did not expect to see Keith here today, especially after seeing him in the hospital this week. He was in pretty rough shape. Keith has had about 10% of his kidney removed and had cancer. And this is your second bout with cancer, right, Keith? So keep Keith in prayer. He still needs a lot of prayer. And then keep Roderick in prayer. He's still having a lot of back problems and other health issues. And then also, I appreciate if you pray for my mom. She's looking at surgery over the next week or so, and then she's going to have radiation treatment and even possibly chemotherapy. I don't know about that. So we want to get her moved up here, but right now she has to deal with this. So I'd appreciate your prayer concerning that. Am I missing anybody? Oh, thank you. Etta had back surgery, and she's having some complications to that, and she's really going to have to be kind of laid up for about a month or so. So pray for Etta. Pray for her recovery. I miss anybody else. Pray for Weifel. He's back, but he's got some serious knee problems and might hinder his ability to drive, it looks like. So appreciate your prayer for Weifel. Okay, so keep those things in prayer. Open your Bibles now to Hebrews chapter 13. And by the way, there are Bible reading schedules out on the foyer table. You need to be regularly in your Bible. You don't have to go by that schedule. You don't have to read the Bible through in a year. I encourage you to do that. You could read the New Testament through in a year. You could read Psalms and Proverbs, but get into some sort of regular schedule of reading and studying the Word of God, and that's one simple way to do it. It really only takes you about 20 minutes a day to read through the Bible in a year. So it's not a huge investment for a really big return on your small time investment, but do it prayerfully. All right, Hebrews chapter 13. And I ought to get there too. All right, Hebrews 13. And let's begin reading in verse 1. I'm going to read verses 1 through 4 of Hebrews 13. Says, let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. Let's pray. God, we're so thankful for your word. And Lord, I pray for these that were mentioned, Lord, that have some serious illness. And God, I pray that you'd have your hand upon them. Pray for healing. I pray, Lord, for peace and in the face of these trials that they're confronted with. And Lord, we pray that you would have your hand. Pray that they would look to you for spiritual strength, physical strength, and healing and comfort. And God, I ask your blessings on those folks that were mentioned. And I pray for this message this morning, a subject that's so important and so often maligned in our culture. And Lord, I pray that it would not be a subject that we would be ignorant about and that we would take lightly as believers. Lord, thankful for what you'll do. We love and praise you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, as we've gone through the book of Hebrews, I feel in a way like I've hit the brakes when we've come to the beginning of chapter 13, because I'm basically handling one verse every week, and I don't normally do that. But these, in some way, I know they're connected, and they are connected, but in some way, the writer of Hebrews is hitting one topic and another topic and another topic and another topic. So the first verse that we looked at was to let brotherly love continue. And one of the things I pointed out with all these things, I believe that as Christians, we're called upon in these areas to kind of go to an extreme about these things. I know that people go to extremes in some crazy areas, climbing Mount Everest. You know, it costs like $65,000 for one person to climb Mount Everest, and 10% of the people don't make it. 10% of the people die trying to do it. So, boy, that's an extreme risk, really an unnecessary risk in my mind, and maybe not to some people, but there's areas, you know, they have these extreme sports, and people go to extremes doing this, doing that, jumping out. A guy jumped out of an airplane just about a month ago without a parachute, first time ever. Anyone see that? He landed on a net. The net was big, but when you're up that high, that net is really small, and he was able to land on that net. That's extreme. And that's kind of not asking you, and I don't think God is asking us to go to those kinds of extremes. But in these areas, we're really called upon to go to an extreme. Let brotherly love continue. We are not to treat each other as brothers and sisters in Christ. We're not to treat each other as mere acquaintances. We're to treat each other like family should treat each other. Maybe not like your family does treat each other, but like family should treat each other. We're to constantly check and monitor this area of behavior as Christians. As I pointed out in some of the illustrations I use in that message, we're not to let it drift. We're not to let it be eroded. We don't want to let our church become a club or a dead organization where a group of people simply congregate and meet every once in a while, and that's the extent of their interaction. No, we need to let brotherly love, true brotherly love, godly Christian brotherly love, we need to let it remain. We need to show hospitality according to verse 2. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers. And I use some of the extreme examples that God's people, that we have in the Bible, of God's people going to extremes in the area of hospitality. One that I mentioned was the Good Samaritan. Look at the extreme that Jesus told that story, and look at the extreme that the Good Samaritan went to show hospitality to this hurted or harmed, robbed, beaten individual. And then last week, we were called upon to be mindful of those suffering for the faith. And it's not that we're just to bring them to mind. Look at verse 3. It says, remember them that are in bonds as bound with them. Anyone can think about them. Anyone can read about those people. Anyone can kind of consider the fact that people are suffering and are being persecuted for their Christian faith. But we're called upon to do it in a way as bound with them. We're called to suffer adversity. We're called to pray for those and remember those that suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body. That's a more extreme way to deal with it. That's a more extreme way to remember it. And I think the reason for that is because if we remembered it in that way, if we remembered someone in bonds in that way, if we remembered someone suffering adversity in that way, we would be more drawn to prayer. Because I guarantee you, if you are the one imprisoned, or if you are the one suffering for your faith, you certainly would be doing some praying. Amen? So that's what should draw us to do. Today we're going to see that we're called to another extreme in yet another area of our lives. And this is an extreme measure, especially when you view and you keep in mind and consider the direction that our culture is going in this particular area that's dealt with in verse 4. And the first word is marriage. Think about what direction that's going. This is an extreme measure in relation to that. It's an area that God has laid out from the beginning of man. And since the fall, when sin entered the picture, it's an area that Satan and wicked mankind has twisted and perverted in every possible direction. And unfortunately, the Christian community and the local churches have not been immune to that. There's a clear contrast set forth on this verse, in verse 4. There's a clear contrast set forth within the verse. Which side of the contrast are you on? Which side do you take in the two sides that are considered here in verse 4 in Hebrews chapter 13? On the one side, and really Folks, this passage, Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4, is about one's view of sex. That's what it's about. I know that's a touchy issue, and maybe it makes your hair on the back of your neck stand up a little bit, but that's what this passage is about. What side do you come down on in that area? On the one side, you have a view of sex that is holy and pure and undefiled before God, and that is sex within the confines of a married couple. Look at verse 4. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. The marriage bed undefiled. Now that might be kind of a euphemism there. It's kind of a replacement word for it. But that's talking about sex when it says the bed is undefiled. The marriage bed is undefiled. So the one side, you have this view that is that sex is pure and holy. You know, there are those that love to paint Bible believers, especially if you watch the TV. There are those that love to paint Bible-believing Christians as Victorian Puritan prudes. By the way, there's really probably nothing wrong with being Victorian. Maybe not anything wrong with the Victorian era. And there's really nothing wrong with the Puritans. But there is something wrong with being a prude. And Christians are not a prude or should not be a prude in this area. They paint a view that Christians, this is the view that they paint. This is what we often get labeled with Bible-believing Christians. We get labeled with the idea that we think that sex is some sort of necessary evil. And first of all, these people obviously have not read the Bible. Because it's not like we're not aware that it's out there. The Bible contains just about every aspect of sex. By the way, both good and bad. If you've read your Bible, the Bible contains every aspect of it, both good and bad. The difference is, the Bible shows us the way in which mankind has perverted it. And then the Bible also shows us and points us toward God's wonderful plan for sex inside of marriage and the blessings that come along with it. If you're a Christian, then God has called you, as this passage clearly presents, God has called you to come down on this side of the issue. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. On the other side, really, what is presented here is those that stand for immorality, adultery, and fornication, violating the marriage vow, and thus dishonoring God's created institution, the God-created institution. The word whoremongers here, I mentioned this briefly in Sunday school because it came up with another verse, another word that we're looking at in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. The word whoremongers here is the same root word as the word fornication that appears many times in the Bible, and that is the word pornos. And we get a very obvious, probably don't have to have a Greek scholar, which I'm not, to understand what English word comes from that Greek word pornos. It's the English word pornography. And you know, pornography is a practice today that is so pervasive. It's just unbelievable. You know, there was a day when you could kind of surprise people to tell them how much money was spent on a particular thing. In fact, I mentioned this to my wife last night as we're sitting drinking our Diet Coke at Cracker Barrel. I said, do you know how much money is spent? And I think I said it wrong last night. Do you know how much money is spent a year by Americans? And I think it's just by Americans, by the way, per year on soft drinks. $65 billion. I think that's just America. Maybe it's worldwide, but that's still a lot of money. Well, there was a time, and I've even quoted the statistic, because I think at one time I had heard that people were spending $13 billion a year spending it on pornography. $13 billion a year. That's an unbelievable figure. Okay? Well, that's a deceptive figure today. You want to know why? Because people can get it for free. It's one click away. It's one smartphone away. It's one iPad away. And it's totally free. So to say this figure, this dollar figure, to shock you is totally irrelevant because it's more pervasive than that because it's free. Satan has really went on the offensive in this area. There was a time when a man had to sneak off to the seediest side of town and sneak off into a bookstore, hoping that no one would see him. Well, now we live in a time when a man or a woman can wait till the family goes to bed and in the den or in the basement can get on the internet, get on the smartphone anywhere, and it's right in front of them. I want you to listen. I want you to listen to a quote from, this is from a book called Losing Our Vision, Why the Church Must Recover Its Moral Vision by a guy by the name of David Wells. Listen to this. While the great majority of Americans believe that they can actually keep the Ten Commandments, only 13% think that each of these commandments has moral validity. It's no surprise to learn that 74% said that they will steal without compunction. 64% say that they will lie if there's an advantage to be had in doing so. 53% say that given a chance, they will commit adultery. 41% say that they intend to use recreational drugs. 30% say that they will cheat on their taxes. I'm surprised that that's not higher, but anyway. What may be the clearest indicator of the disappearance of moral texture to society is the loss of guilt and embarrassment over moral lapses. While 86% admit to lying regularly to their parents, 75% to a friend, 73% to a lover, only 11% cited lying as having produced some serious level of guilt. So everyone admits, yeah, I do it, but only 11% say that it produces any guilt. While 74% will steal without compunction, only 9% register any moral disquiet over it. While pornography has blossomed into a $4 billion industry, and like I said, that figure is irrelevant, for a quarter of all the videos rented in shops, which this is an older book, so it's really irrelevant, seen in the thriving hotel business on the cable, only 2% experience guilt about watching. And not surprisingly, at the center of this slide into license and moral relativism is the disappearance of God. Only 17% define sin as a violation of God's will. And I'm sure that that carries over to the subject that we're talking about, of course, with marriage. And on the subject of pornography, I would point out that it is not a victimless crime. Young women are often trapped into it because of addiction. Many times they're forced into it. Many times they're lured into it because of the big money. Unfortunately, they're left with the lifelong guilt. They risk STDs or sexually transmitted diseases. They risk pregnancy that oftentimes in those cases ends where? In abortion. And more problems of guilt are added on to that. And then add to that all the people that suffer an addiction to pornography, which, by the way, is the same kind of addiction. Same kind of chemical things go on in people's minds with that as with a drug addiction. Very difficult, very difficult. And we can't be neutral in this area. The writer of Hebrews was possibly responding to problems that Christians were encountering in their day. Look at the verse again. I want to kind of focus just for a second on the second part of it, and then I'm going to make the major part of focus on my message on the first part of it, because I don't want you to leave here with all those negative thoughts, and I don't want you to leave here with all that kind of bad taste in your mouth, but this is what the Bible deals with. This is how the Bible addresses it, and it comes in the way of a warning. But whoremongers, and remember, that's pornos, fornicators, pornography, adultery, fornication, whoremongers and adulterers, what does it say? God will judge. God will judge. The writer of Hebrews is probably responding to problems that Christians were encountering in their day, especially, I would say, toward, like, for instance, with the Corinthians and then with the Ephesians. They were living in the midst of pagan culture. Well, guess what? We might call our country a quote-unquote Christian nation. We might call it that. Well, you better not ever lose sight of the fact that you are living in the midst of a pagan culture. Doesn't take very long to see that and look around. The problems that they encountered, there were people that advocated in the time that this was written and in many of the cities where Christians were getting saved in the midst of paganism, there were people that advocated complete abstinence from any sort of sexual activity. I think that's one of the things that Paul addresses in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. They went so far as to look at marriage itself as wrong and sinful. They were right about abstinence outside of marriage, but to place a burden on someone that was not called toward this was wrong and asking for trouble. One of the so-called, quote, early church fathers, a guy by the name of Origen, went so far as to have himself castrated. This was a sinful and wrong view of morality. The correct view is in verse 4. Marriage is honorable and the bed undefiled. Marriage is honorable. And then the other side of the problem was the hedonists, and they're defined kind of in the second part of the verse. The whoremongers and the adulterers, the hedonists would say that they say anything goes. There were even those, even sometimes under the guise of Christianity, that would say that our spirits are, this was a really cultic belief connected with paganism that the early church had to deal with, where they would say that our bodies are separated from our spirit. So it doesn't matter what we do in our bodies because our spirits won't be affected by it. And that was also an extreme view. Therefore, they said you could do anything. And Paul deals with that in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. As we look over the national landscape of our country and the condition of marriage and of family in our culture, we might be tempted to have a knee-jerk reactions and provide our own wisdom to assess the causes and provide solutions. When really, in reality, the only solution to it is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the solution. Families are breaking apart. Children are growing up, not only without their father because of maybe the marriage split up, but without any father at all in the home, and sometimes not even knowing their biological father. And that affects our society. And we might say, well, there's a solution to that. We got to restore the family. Yes, we need to restore the family. But the real solution is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And as Christians, we have to realize that. That is the real solution to the problem. It's not moralism. Moralism isn't, I'm good. I get the moral aspect of it. And we need to promote morality. But the real solution is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Marriage is honorable in all. I'm blessed. I've been married for about 30 years. Is that right? 30 years? But there's never been a time that I got to the point where I thought, you know, I don't need to learn anything more about being a better husband. I don't need to learn anything more about having a better marriage. Maybe I have kind of thought that, but I was woken up. I was awakened to that very quickly. And if you're here today and say, you know what? My marriage doesn't need any help. I don't need to improve as a husband, or I don't need to improve as a wife. If you're here saying my marriage doesn't need any help, then there's probably someone with the same last name as you that would say otherwise. And certainly we all could use help in our marriage. We could all improve. We haven't arrived. This goes for husbands and wives. So let me answer the question today with about five quick things in the time that we have. Why is marriage honorable in all? That's the section I want to focus on. Why is marriage? The passage here says marriage is honorable in all and the bed undefiled. Let me give you about five things. Number one is this. Marriage is honorable because it is the creation of God. And by the way, that creation came before the fall. That creation came before the fall. I want you to turn to Genesis chapter 2 with me. Would you do that? Genesis chapter 2. And I want you to listen to verse 1. Because I found it interesting or intriguing in a way that this passage starts off with this chapter, and then it ends with something else. So let's see what it starts with. It says, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. That's such a majestic verse. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. All God's creation is finished. And we will walk out into our yards. We can look at the trees, and we look at the flowers, and we look at the robin that I saw yesterday, amen? And we can look up into the sky at nighttime in a clear blue sky, a clear sky at night, and we can see all the stars, and we can say, the heavens declare the glory of God. And we could praise God for God's creation in Genesis chapter 2, that the heavens and the earth were finished and all the host of him, and God is the creator, and we can praise God. Now skip down towards the end of the chapter, and beginning with verse 18. And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him. And out of the ground, the Lord formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all cattle and fowl of the air and every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found an helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. And my simple point in bringing this up is that when I get to Genesis chapter 2, and I read that first verse, and I think of God's creation, and I think of the glory of the heavens and say that it declares his glory, and then I get to the end of the chapter, you know what? I should be no less in awe. God created marriage, and we should stand in awe of God's creation. We should be worshipful at God's creation of marriage, worshipful to God. And we should want to say, you know what? I want to elevate this. I want to lift it up as one of God's creation. I don't want to tear it down. I don't want to demean it. I don't want to take it lightly. So number one, marriage is honorable because of creation and the Creator. And then number two, marriage is honorable because it is the foundation for the family. Because it's the foundation for the family. You know, chapter 4 of Genesis is one of those chapters where you're like, okay, chapter 3 is the fall, and chapter 4 is kind of depressing because it's kind of an outcome, a result of the fall. But just take your mind off of that kind of negative outcome that's mentioned in chapter 4, and that's because of the fall. But in chapter 4, verse 1, it says this, and Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she bare again his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the land. And we'll stop right there, because you know what happens next. You know what happens next. Cain kills Abel. But you know what's so great about that passage? I know there's sometimes you read that, and boy, we're even immediately brought to that murder scene. But let's think of the greatness of that passage. In chapter 2, God created marriage. Before that, what did God tell Adam and Eve? He said, be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful and multiply. And chapter 4 and verse 1, that's what we have. This is the basic structure of the family. The basic structure of the family. So marriage is honorable because of creation and the Creator. And then marriage is honorable because it's the foundation of society. It's the foundation of, really, even in some ways, our church. It's the foundation of, as we look around, and look how much under attack. Look how under attack God's creation of marriage is. It's demeaned. It's perverted. It's twisted. It's even not even called a creation of God. It's whatever man wants it to be. No, we're going to ignore what God said marriage is, that it's between one man and one woman for one lifetime. We're going to ignore that, and we're going to pervert it. We're going to twist it. We're going to call it this. We're going to completely redefine it. And then that, if we can damage this God's creation over here, then the outcome is we damage God's basic structure of society, which is the family. Abortion, homosexuality, divorce, it's Satan's attack on marriage. Number three, So marriage is honorable because of the Creator, and it as it is God's creation. And marriage is honorable because it's the basic of family structure. And then thirdly, marriage is honorable because it is a place for expressing ultimate love and intimacy. That is not to say that marriage is the only place that we as Christians should show affection towards each other. We talked about it over the past couple of weeks. Let brotherly love continue. We should show affection towards each other. Let Paul called people, Christians, his beloved. We should be loving towards each other. We should show affection towards each other. There's nothing wrong with friends showing affection towards each other. There's nothing wrong with guys. The Bible says First Samuel, I believe it is, where it says, or Second Samuel, where it says that David and Jonathan loved each other so much that their souls were knit together. There's nothing wrong with a couple of guys saying, man, I love you. Maybe even giving each other a hug. The problem is that society has so perverted it that we're almost afraid to show any level of affection in those areas. But you know, there's nothing like family love. There's nothing like families that love each other and show affection towards each other. There's nothing like friends that can show affection towards each other. Maybe giving each other a hug every once in a while. But there's no place where we can express the ultimate affection, intimacy, and love like we can and should in marriage. It's great to have a strong family growing up. It's great to have a mom and a dad that care about you and provide a positive, loving relationship. It's great to have brothers and sisters. But none of these relationships come close in comparison to the loving relationship that marriage brings. We move away from mom and dad. Siblings go their separate ways, have their own families, and have their own careers. But God has provided this marriage relationship so that we can express that intimacy in an ultimate way and for an ultimate time. Many of our traditions, even in the wedding, picture biblical intimate marriage relationship. In Genesis, it said, no more two, but one flesh. Exodus and Deuteronomy have many laws to preserve the sanctity of marriage. Leviticus, there's laws of purity to preserve the sanctity of marriage. Ruth presents a dramatic love story that honors purity and honors marriage. Listen to Proverbs chapter 5, verses 15 through 19 says this, drink waters out of thine own cisterns, and running waters out of thine own well. Let thy fountains be dispersed abroad, and rivers of water in the streets. Let them be only thine own, and not strangers with thee. Let thy fountain be blessed, and rejoice with the wife of thy youth. Let her be as the loving hind and the pleasant roe. Let her breast satisfy thee at all times, and be thou ravished always with her love. Song of Solomon is a beautiful poetic picture of intimate love. And then we get up in the New Testament, Ephesians chapter 5, and the passage that we're looking at right here. So marriage is honorable because it is a creation of God. Marriage is honorable because it is the foundation for the family and for society even. And marriage is honorable because it's a place where we can have ultimate intimacy. And then number four, marriage is honorable because it pictures the relationship between Christ and the church. Turn with me very briefly to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. I'm only going to read a few verses from this passage, but I want to read verses 1 and 2 of Ephesians chapter 5. Notice the way the chapter starts out. Ephesians 5, verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. Now skip up to verse 21, and Tim read this passage this morning. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church and the Savior of the body. Therefore, so as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. And over again there is this marriage picture of the relationship between Christ and the church. What a beautiful picture is painted there. So obviously, when we think of it, that Jesus, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, and Jesus loved us so much, he gave himself for the church. That to me says, if that picture, if God is willing in his word, which obviously is as we've read it, he's willing to take that unbelievable love of sending his Son, his only Son, to die on the cross for our sins and say, that's that marriage and that has a relationship. There's a picture there that tells me marriage is honorable. It's placed up on an honorable scale. Lastly, number five, marriage is honorable because it is the culmination of the church. Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. Let me skip up to verse 5. And a voice came out of the throne saying, praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And as I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. The church is called in the scriptures the bride of Christ. The culmination of the church's relationship to Christ is at that marriage supper of the Lamb in the end times. So marriage is honorable. When it comes to this issue, I'm well aware that we live in a fallen world. And with this issue, it doesn't take very long to look around and see the very fallenness of our world. Sin leaves broken pieces. God has been gracious. I believe God's been gracious to me. He's given me a wonderful wife. He's given me 5 wonderful children, and I claim it as by the grace of God. I don't deserve it, nor am I worthy of it. Therefore, I don't look down my nose at others who have had a brokenness maybe in their marriage. I don't look down my nose at them in pride. God can bring healing, and God can bring restoration. That's what the gospel's about. The gospel is about restoring people unto God through the Lord Jesus Christ. But at the same time, we need to restore our families and our marriages and purity to the place that God has called us to. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. We need to root out actions and attitudes, or maybe I'll say it the other round, attitudes that lead to actions in our marriages, in our individual attitudes towards our spouse. We need to root them out. Let me ask you a question. What are you doing? I made that statement at the beginning where, you know, if you don't think that your marriage can have improvement, if you don't think that you as a husband can improve in the way that you treat and honor your wife, and you don't think that you as a wife can improve, I said it before, you're delusional. We can always improve. Just think of the fact that the Bible says, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church. There's never going to be a time in my life where I say, hey, I did it. I've accomplished that. No, I'll always be pursuing that. So let me ask you this. Think right now in your mind, what are you doing now to strengthen your marriage? What are you doing now to improve your relationship with your wife? How many verses on this subject can you think of? How many verses on marriage can you think of? How many of them do you have memorized? How many verses on being a better wife or being a better husband do you have memorized? Can you bring up at your fingertips? make a commitment to take active steps.
We'd like to thank you for joining us for today's broadcast of Fellowship Baptist Church. We would love to have you join us for one of our services. We're located at 41 North Bedford Road in Battle Creek, Michigan. Our zip code is 49037. The times of our services, we have Sunday school for all ages at 10 o'clock on Sundays, and then 11 o'clock is our morning worship service, and then we also have a 6 p.m. service every Sunday except for the fourth Sunday of the month. You can also visit us on the web at fellowshipbattlecreek.org. That's fellowshipbattlecreek.org. Thank you once again for joining us for this broadcast.
AccessVision, your voice, your community.